May 1st, 2014. A NASA plane is monitoring ice thickness over Greenland, an Arctic wilderness more than twice the size of Texas. Below them, the crew notices something unusual.
We have this wide expanse of... But then there's an object.
It appears to be this blackened arm coming out of the ice.
Image analyst Mark D'Antonio dials up the magnification and discovers something disturbing.
You can see a little bit more detail about what we have here. This is actually an aircraft wing and part of an aircraft fuselage.
The idea of being in a plane crash is scary enough, but then imagining crashing in a place like this that's so desolate, so remote, that's gotta be one of the most frightening things imaginable.
But not as frightening as what the team spots in the snow next to the plane.
These are big animal tracks. And in this part of Greenland, there's really only one thing that could make them. Polar bears.
Polar bears can consume over 300 pounds of meat in a single sitting. That's roughly 1.5 pilots.
If you find yourself in this part of the world, especially if you are sick or injured, you are now part of the food chain, and not at the top.
Aviation records reveal that there have been no large plane crashes in this area for decades. A search of World War II accidents yields a possible clue.
There was a B-17 that was dispatched during World War II looking for a cargo plane that went missing. That B-17 crashed in this general area.
Could this be it? Is this the plane that went down?
On November 9th, 1942, a B-17 Flying Fortress takes off from one of the U.S. military's World War II air bases in Greenland to search for a cargo plane that crashed 4 days earlier. But the B-17 also crashes.
The plane crashes, but it's a controlled crash, and the 9 crewmen survive.
The military dispatches a seaplane, which rescues 2 of the stranded crewmen before returning to pick up one more.
And then, you're not gonna believe what happens, that plane then crashes, and all 3 men on board are killed.
Over the following weeks, the military launches several attempts to rescue the remaining stranded airmen. All fail. The 6 crew members and a rescue sled driver who had managed to reach them must face the onslaught of an Arctic winter protected only by the wrecked fuselage of their B-17.
They're there for an entire month. Now, what's it like being for a month on the Arctic? It's hell.
It's minus 40 degrees. You are in a world of hurt.
One of the crew members develops gangrene in both his feet, and they actually fall off inside his boots.
Tormented by hunger, frostbite, and delirium, on January 4th, 1943, the team splits up. A month later, a search team finds 3 of them alive. And on March 18th, after 133 days alone on the ice, the remaining crew find sanctuary.
Their absolutely remarkable survival is one of the great endurance stories of all time.
Analysts consider if the image has captured the crew's wrecked plane locked in the ice for over 70 years. Yet when D'Antonio carefully studies its wing, he casts doubt on this idea.
When you look at the size of the wingspan from wingtip to wingtip, this distance is about 140 feet. That's too large for B-17. I would bank on this being a B-29 Superfortress crash.
Aviation journalist Joe PAPPALARDO confirms that B-29 Superfortresses made frequent flights over Greenland as part of the United States Cold War surveillance campaign.
They were dubbed ferret flights because they were trying to ferret out information about the Soviet Union and all their clandestine airfields.
PAPPALARDO learns that in 1947, one of these superfortresses, called the Keybird, crashes near the site in the aerial image.
This 11-man crew hits a very bad storm. The B-29 comes down, but everyone on board survives.
The B-29 remains untouched for 47 years. In 1994, a team of engineers arrive at the crash site, determined to make her airworthy again and spend months fitting new engines, propellers, and wheels.
Great idea, I suppose. I don't know that I'd want to spend 10 months in those conditions re-kitting engines on a B-29, but that's what they did.
On May 21st, 1995, the team fires up the Superfortress's engines, and she prepares to take to the skies for the first time in half a century. But then a fuel leak in the fuselage starts a fire that quickly engulfs the plane, destroying it in minutes.
That had to be heart-wrenching. I can't even imagine what they felt.
It's like Greenland might be cursed, right? I mean, you couldn't write that ending.
Today, the Keybird remains locked in the Greenland ice, a haunting relic of the Cold War, frozen in time.
In a way, I think it's fitting that she didn't fly off. She's like a memorial to all those brave men who flew those missions over that part of the world.